Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. And thanks to all of you for joining me here for my dissertation defense today. Thanks to my committee members, Dr. Dong, Dr. Prasad, my advisor, Dr. Sheth, Srini, and Patrick also joining me on this Skype. I thank you, my committee members, for helping me shape my thought process from the proposal to defense today. And we'll be discussing today, how do we mine citizen-centered communities for cooperation with the organizational actors? So we are going to follow first, what are the citizen-centered communities? What are organizations? What are the cooperation challenges between them? What are the contributions in addressing those that we have made? And the applications and limitations of them. So first, let's discuss what are these citizen-centered communities and organizations. So in the Web 1.0 era, citizens used to be recipients of information. But in the era of Web 2.0, people became generators of information. So they started acting as active sensors who generate information, who interact with other sensors, other citizens. However, the data that gets generated by the citizen sensor is massive, and it brings a lot of challenges because it's a natural language text, it's unstructured text, it's unconstrained natural language because citizens are free to use the kind of vocabulary that they want. So it brings challenges in, for ambiguity in interpreting the messages or text, sparsity of specific behaviors. As well as diversity of the users who are generating the information and the scale of the data that they can generate. So challenge for processing. So my goal has been understanding this noisy citizen sensor data for the purpose of organizational decision making. In computer science, there has been a lot of work on mining large-scale data, and there is expertise on analyzing the citizen sensor data and address some of the challenges that we discussed above. While in social sciences, there has been rich literature in understanding these organization processes and the decision making. But however, they were limited by small scale of the data and the computation. So my research fits at the intersection of these two. And the scope of my research is, how do we perform computing on data that actually is informed by the organizational decision makers so that it can help the decision making. So objective or the goal is really going from the data to the decision making. In this process, let's understand the structure of organizations. So organizations have structured rules. They have a defined task. They have priorities, and they collect data, they process the data, and they share the data and make decisions on the data. While on the citizen-centered communities, there is no structure, defined structures, and defined tasks. When some events occur in the world, there is massive data that's being generated. So the organizations on the other side consider this as an opportunity, which they didn't have before Web 2.0 era. So the question comes that, can citizens really help organizations? And citizens, yes, they want to help, but the question really is how they can help. And the question to answer to that question is a cooperative system design. So there has been research on cooperative system design in the computer-supported cooperative area research domain. So they divide this kinds of system design based on time and space. So in the CSCW research metric, people can be there as an actor in the cooperative system at the same place or at different places. Our focus lies in the bottom two quadrants of this, that citizens and different actors, they may be anywhere, anytime. And so the question comes in the design to consider the aspects on the bottom two quadrants. So now, once we have this kind of approach to address this connection between citizens and organizations, there are challenges in designing such cooperative system. So in the prior literature, they identified two fundamental challenges among many. One is the awareness that about sharing of the knowledge so that organization actors can make proper decisions. The other is the articulation challenge. Articulation challenge is about a specific clear division of responsibilities and tasks. So that organization actors can perform things efficiently. My goal is to pick a piece of pie from these two challenges and address one question in the awareness that whom to engage first. This is actually a prioritization problem in computer science, where our goal is that we want to model the engagement at whom to prioritize to engage. In articulation, we want to, the question that organization actor want to ask is, where are the resources corresponding to the specific task? What kind of resources are there? What kind of availabilities are there? These are clearly well-separated tasks in their workflows. So we want to address this question by mining the citizen-sensitive data that what kind of intents are existing in the data. So what we have done here is we have observed design problem, and in the design problem, there are computational challenges that can be addressed, which in turn will help the design of such a cooperative system. So the research question here, first is, given that there has been a lot of work in social sciences, in psycholinguistics, about understanding the organization, understanding the conversations, the first question is, a given conversation is fundamental to cooperation. Can offline theories of conversation be applied in computing online social data? Second question is, can we model the intentions? We talked about it's related, the articulation problem could be addressed with intent mining, but what kind of intent? Could we model those intent? And third, can we find the reliable groups to engage first? So we will address these three questions. There has been work on modeling the group dynamics using structure-based matrices. Our aim here is the content-based matrices. So our specific thesis statement to address this research questions is using the prior knowledge and using the interplay of users, their content, and the network structure, we can efficiently model intent and engagement for the purpose of cooperation in the communities. So we will see what kind of prior knowledge exists and what kind of user content network features we are discussing. The scope of our work here in discussion is the for intent. Intent is about aim for action. So aim for action which assists the cooperation system. So for example, citizens who are offering help during disasters, citizens who are needing help, or the specific actors which are needing help. So awareness of such information will be helpful. And the second thing is the engagement, which is defined as an involvement in an activity. So we want to model involvement in an activity of the citizens. So specific contributions that we have made in addressing these cooperative system design challenges and intent and engagement modeling. First is the operationalization of cooperative system design with the computing. So addressing awareness and articulation using intent and engagement model. Second, improving the computation of online social data by leveraging the rich knowledge of the offline conversations. Third, improving the intent classification performance using the fusion of top-down, this knowledge that we are talking about, knowledge sources, and the bottom-up approaches. And fourth, improving the explanation of group engagement. And in doing so, leveraging content in contrast to just structure-based approaches. So, here, the scope of our data is the platform that we have worked with Twitter. As you might be aware, Library of Congress is archiving all the data on Twitter. Why? There is a plethora of human interactions in that data, and that is very valuable can be very valuable for different kinds of purposes. And so for our organization also, Twitter has played an extremely important role. So this was one of our platform. And also for the use cases that we discussed, like we are going to discuss here as well, crisis or disasters during those natural disasters, this network play an important role. The characteristics of this network is that there are users who follow each other, it's like subscribing each other. They generate content, like status updates about what they are observing, what are their opinions, they express what they are feeling. And the third network, that it's a directed network where when one person follows other, the other person gets information from the first person. So in this having this characteristic, there are some functions from this platform which support or which facilitate conversation. As we discussed, conversation is fundamental to cooperation, so these functions are also going to be critical. So a reply-based conversation function is a given a particular message, people are on that chain. They're creating a chain of conversation on it. Second, the retweet. Third is the mention. Retweet is like your email forwarding, while the mention-based conversation would be acknowledging someone and then doing the conversation. So in this, the first problem that we want to address is, and we want to observe, that can offline theories of conversation can give us indicators which can support the conversation classification in the online way. So our problem is that given that these reply, retweet, mention, they reflect conversation, such as in this example, that first person is that analyzing conversation Twitter using platform provided functions, reply, retweet, mentions, let's suppose it's me. And my friend in psychology, he says that, hey dude, wait a minute. I kind of feel that, you know, one might be needing more than just platform conversation. And he is, you know, acknowledging my name over there. He's trying to, there is a, create an implicit exchange of ideas here. And that's the conversation. So we consider that also a form of conversation. This has been studied in the prior literature as well, in terms of what kinds of conversations are there. So in this task, we want to ask this question. Can general theories of conversation be applied in the online context? And for to address that, a specific problem, the task that we have is, given a set of messages, classify a sample of these messages between two pairwise classes. For example, reply versus not replying, retweet versus not replying, mention versus not replying. Now, this RT, RPMN, these basically we define as a corpuses, and we consider them as a ground truth corpuses based on if they use the construct of the reply function, of retweet function, or mention function. And we consider here sample size to be 3 based on the reply conversation size when we did the perform the experimentation. So here, let's talk about what kinds of online theories were there. And we observed that there were psycholinguistic indicators which were studied, which facilitate some sort of cooperation in the environment. And such as the determiners, the versus an, and dialogue management, such as thanks, anyway. These are the cues. And just to note here, often these kinds of cues are thrown away in text classification, because they do not matter for topic classification purposes. While we will see that these kinds of actors, these kinds of cues are important when we are discussing the problems for intent-related mining. So one of the drawbacks actually in this observation of this offline study was these were small-scale studies, right? So obviously there was challenge that these were observed in the positive conversation instances. What is the role in the negative conversation instances? So that's also something we want to address using this. And so here our hypothesis is that offline theoretical features are discriminative for the online conversation. And these features also correlate with information density in those messages. We will see how. So the conversation classification and the kind of features for that, we observe as these different categories that we observed from the literature. So determiners, subject pronouns, dialogue management indicators. So each of this function is a term frequency-based function that we created. And we compute their term frequency, we normalize it, and we have this 14 feature categories with us. So when we perform classification on data sets of 3 disasters and 3 non-disasters, and in that, they were like varying sizes data sets. Also, they were from different time periods, and they were reflecting different characteristics. And in doing so, we observed by doing the classification with the dissentry classifier and then doing the evaluation with tenfold cross-validation, we observed accuracy around 70% up to 78%, and AUC also ranging up to 0.8%. AUC is the area under the curve for the receiver operating characteristics. So here, when we observed the discriminative features, we observed that there were consistent TOF features of these specific kinds, pronouns, dialogue management, determiners, and also word count. So the dialogue management and pronouns and these determiners, these were the studied behaviors in the offline conversations, that they were important. And here also we observe them as important. We actually also did correlation study to observe that were these features also correlating with the platform-based conversations, like reply, retweet, and mention. And then we observed correlation coefficient up to 0.69, positive correlation coefficient. So it made us intrigued that can we go and find that now what kind of deeper content aspects are available in these kinds of conversations. And we took LIWC as a tool for doing this analysis. And LIWC is a tool for doing in psychology based different categories analysis. And so our focus here was things which relate to the cooperation. So social interactions, sensed experience, and communication. So for each of these categories, psychologists have come up with a set of lexicons. And so they compute the measures using those lexicons to tell us how that content is reflective of these categories. And we analyze the output. Yes.
So when you talk about offline, can you describe precisely what you did when you talk about offline conversation? Mm-hmm. Are you talking about the fact that this is what traditionally has been done in the literature, or did you do something specific in the offline context?
It's something which has already been done in the offline version. So from there, we looked at the literature. We identified what kind of psycholinguistic cues were observed there and use those as to create a feature categories for this classification problem.
So related to that, a clarification, mm-hmm. are the same set of cues common in online conversation?
Yes, Shini, that's what we observed. But they vary by different degrees, and that's why we said the top out of 14, these four categories that I discussed in the previous, let me just go here, the previous slide, that determiners or pronouns, subject pronouns, the dialogue management indicators, they were discriminative here.
I'll have a question related to this later on.
Yes, Shini.
Thank you. Okay.
So now, when we perform, we analyze the output of this different classification output sets for true positive sets and the true negative set, and similarly false positive and so on. So here we observed higher values for the positive classified conversation. And that suggested higher information for cooperative intent here, given the kinds of category that we were analyzing. So that gave us two important lessons. One was that offline theoretic features of conversation exist in the online environment. And so therefore, we have an opportunity to leverage this for computing the online social data. Second, such features correlate with the information density in content, and that information density related with the cooperative behavior. And that way, that's also give us an opportunity to observe them, that can we utilize these cues for analyzing cooperative intent in the messages. And we will see there are challenges, and that's why we have to do intent mining, trying to understand the concepts of intent in the messages for this purpose. So now we move to the problem two, intent classification. And here, revisiting our thesis statement here, and the component of that prior knowledge, the ones that I have highlighted in red color, that we will show in this problem, that prior knowledge and features of content efficiently model intent for the cooperation of citizens and their communities. So an intent, it's an aim for an action. It's a mental state. You have a goal. You want to, and you express the things related for that goal. And so here are some messages, for example, the red color message, like text Red Cross. So in this messages, there is an intent for seeking of help for the Red Cross. The second message, the anyone know where the nearest Red Cross is, the person wants to give the blood. Right, so that's a kind of an offering intent in the message. The third is the kind of like advising. The person is just advising about preparation. Now, having these various kinds of intent, our question here is, can we identify relevant intent from ambiguous and unconstrained natural language types? So Here, the challenge is that we do not want to identify all kinds of intent. There are several intents being expressed in the message. What we want to identify are the intents which relate with the addressing the articulation challenge of the cooperative system. And so those were seeking and offering resources. So having that, we formulated our problem that, yes, you have a variety of intentions in the messages. And so, yes, there are several interpretation of this natural language text is possible. What we want to formulate is we want to constrain it, make it tractable. So we want to say that for the given category of intent classes, classify this corpus for me. So it's an instance of a multi-class classification problem. And our focus here is the cooperation system intent classes. There has been work in intent classification in other areas. We will discuss them in the related work section. So let's look at first the type of text classification. Now, obviously, to one, it will appear that it's a text classification problem. But however, it's a text classification problem of a specific kind. For example, in the topic classification, the focus is on the predominant subject matter, like whether it is about sports, whether it's about entertainment. So if you look at the message example that I have in the bottom, so in that text message, it's I'm going to watch movie, the awesome Fast and Furious movie. For the topic, the focus is on that movie, that Fast and Furious movie. Second, there has been work on sentiment and emotion analysis, opinion mining. Our friend Lou does here the work on that, and Venbo also. And they focus on the present state, that what is the present state of the author that author is there talking about in the document. And like, for example, negative, positive emotion. So in the example message that we are discussing here, like awesome movie, excited. So those are the kinds of cues that opinion mining or sentiment and emotion mining look for. In the intent mining, for the purpose is that, can we classify this document for the action? The focus is on the action. What is the future state of action here? So for example, in the message here, going to watch, so that's actually, watching is basically the intent in that message. But in the, for example, in the case of crisis, offering help or asking for help, those are the kinds of examples of intent. Then we look at the kinds of data which has been analyzed for intent mining. So first, a lot of emphasis has been done on search queries. So when we go to Google, we type about a particular dedicated goal that we have, that I want to buy a laptop, for example. So that's the dedicated goal, and people type over there, and so we have a corresponding results. So in there, the focus has been like user profiling and the query classification. However, those intent, whatever they have analyzed, like they depend on this large query logs. And we don't have those large query logs. We don't have relevance feedback results. We don't have the click graphs that what user have acted on. Another thing is that there is a social context. They don't have social context. There is no conversation going on there which may incorporate the social cues. Second, the kind of text, formal text, for example, presidential speeches, web pages and blogs, they have been analyzed in another kind of data. There the focus was on knowledge acquisition. They wanted to understand the human goals, what kinds of variety of human goals. Again, there has been work in psychology and social sciences about understanding the human goals. However, operationalizing them is a challenging task. And this line of work tried to address them when there was a rich amount of data. However, the challenge that we're going to address here is that when you have a short text, in the user-generated text, it does not have this luxury of having the grammatically correct sentences, for example, so that if you want to employ dependency parsers in a natural language processing, they are not going to work effectively. The third is the kind of work is the commercial reviews, and that's where, as we all know, whenever there is money, a lot of attention goes there. So a lot of attention went there, and a lot of work was done on understanding the intention for the buying and selling. However, the challenge here was the limited motives. For example, when you think of help, and when you think of selling or buying, help is much broader than actually selling and buying those focused intents. So those kind of challenges we're going to face in our problem because it's an unconstrained natural language in a small space. So there is going to be challenge in ambiguity in interpreting the messages. For example, the message example here, if you look at the blue colored part of it, that actually reflects the sense of offering help. While if you look at the red color part of it, it reflects the sense of seeking help. So it gives a lot of ambiguity in interpreting this message. Second, the sparsity challenge. These kinds of intentions, which are going to be relevant for organizational tasks, they are very limited in the data. There is very sparse, and therefore there is a lot of low signal to noise ratio going on for these classes. And in the Hurricane Sandy data that we had analyzed in a crisis domain, we observed that there was 1% signal, like for seeking and offering help. So that also brings the challenge for this problem to make this hard to predict. So for example, even in the commercial intent, where the problem was very, very specific, there are even the FN scores were 65% in a recent study which was published at www. So in that respect, now to approach this problem, we look at this problem the way prior literature has done in two forms. One is the binary classification, and second is the multi-class classification. Lot of work has been done in the binary classification direction, but not on a generalized multi-class classification direction because of the complexity of the problem. So in the binary classification, the crisis domain, there is one work which we can relate to, is Verga et al.'s work. And that's one work which has really focused on understanding the problem in reports. However, the problem in reports are not exactly same as the seeking and offering intent. However, they're related with it, so we will consider that as a baseline also. The features they employed were syntactic features, like and also the features they generated using the parsings. The NLP-based approaches. So they were using noun word templates. I'll be happy to discuss in detail if you are interested in how they approached that.
Hemant, what were the class labels they used in that study?
Actually, problem and ed. So problem and not problem, ed and not ed. So the two binary classifiers, separate binary classifiers were created. And for the two binary classifier, problem and not problem, and ed and not ed.
So essentially, it was a multi-class problem.
But they broke it, Srin, yeah. So.
But they modeled it as multiple binary classes.
Correct. So because the focus is that, as we discussed, there is going to be challenge for this imbalances in the classes. So for problem, like their classifier performs well, we'll see in the data now. But for the like ed, it does not do that well. So because there is imbalance and also the complexity actually of expressing these different kinds of intent. Yeah, Shani, should I move on?
Please carry on.
Yeah, so and the second kind of work is the commercial intent domain, which relates to in the intent mining for us, was focused on like this buying and selling. And there also they focused on this binary classifications. So again, as she mentioned, yes, they approached as a binary classifier problem rather than multi-class, that all the different greater than two classes, you give the classifier at the same time. So you don't do that, rather you break the problem and then you solve the, so we'll approach it in this different context. In the multi-class case, there is no work on the intent on the Twitter for even in the commercial domain, not in crisis, not even in commercial domain. There is one work which is in the other domain, like other domains data, for example, Amazon.com product reviews and so on. So from these, what inspired us was the kinds of features that they employed in learning these intent classes. One approach was the bottom-up approach, that you try to extract the structure out of data. Another was this top-down approach where they were employing these pattern rules. So people gave rules for the messages, and that's how the rule classifier extracted that, yeah, whether this message is related to this part, intent class one or intent class two. Our approach is merging them and fusing this bottom-up and top-down to create a hybrid approach which can effectively perform for intent classification. If you look at the difference from going from bottom-up to top-down, it's the difference of expressivity. That by defining the rules, you are actually making the representation of a document more expressive in the sense that this document relates with this in particular intent class, as compared to in the bottom-up, where there is assumption of this independent tokens that was taken. when we think of combining from these individual approaches to hybrid approach, our hypothesis is they're here is that it's going to increase the learning for the intent classes. Let's look at what kind of top down. So bag of art model is familiar to I think most of you. So we'll see that. But what kind of top down? Let's look at the various kinds of top down approaches which were taken, and corresponding to that, we also approached as a top down approach. There is a conceptual dependency theory from early days of AI by Roger Shang on natural language understanding, that you can abstract the meaning of the class from the actual instances. It's like in our ontology, or like in Wikipedia, if you think of taxonomies. So the concepts represent a set of instances that they belong to, right? And so those concepts can be abstracted for these intents as well. So that was one thing to start with as a thought process. Another was this verb lexicons. So intent are for action, right? And verbs relate with our actions. So in a recent work in commercial intent also, there was this work on leveraging this verb, resource Levin's verb, and we actually approached it from the psycholinguistic side, that there was this verb lexicon and that could be utilized. Third was the syntactic patterns. People employed in the rules these kinds of question answers, like what, why, how, models, and so on. Word order, like verb, object positions. So having these different three kinds of knowledge to us, then we employed those knowledge into form of rules. And we created this psycholinguistic rules where we are giving this rule to the data and asking whether a message belongs to seeking or whether a message belongs to offering. And in this case, like for example, in these two cases, one for seeking, one for offering, you have in the first message, for example, pronouns accept you, need, want, an adjective, and then think. So think here is actually coming from domain ontology. So you can think of a domain ontology, for example, in a crisis, which leverages the concepts of what are the resources. For example, shelter. So tent, house, all these things relate to shelter, right? So that's the form of an ontology here. So using these kinds of rules, we created a rule-based classifier, and we learned some lessons here. So when we employed the 2000 class for preliminary study, like 2000 classified data using such rules, and then we asked two native English speakers, local to here, to label the different intent classes of seeking, offering, and none. And we observed the results that average F1 score was 78% here, and corresponding to the baseline, like Vega et al.'s work, in that the score was just 57% for both seeking and offering cases. And the lesson here was that yes, there is a role of prior knowledge for domain-independent and dependent cues, however, there is a limitation here that we cannot, how many rules we can create. So there is a limitation here. Second, there is a low recall, obviously, that we are going to face because of the rule-based approaches if we extend to a larger corpus. And then there is going to be ambiguity that we have addressed here because of the rules. However, we are going to face the challenge of imbalance as well as we look into the data. So by hybrid approach, we want to leverage this top-down knowledge in creating better approach. So for the binary classifier design, we first address the issue of ambiguity by creating the rich feature space. So we use the top-down approach where we use the declarative knowledge patterns.
Yeah, I just want to clarify. So ambiguity means multiple intents in the same message.
Yeah, yeah. So by employing the rule, we fix the association that, oh, it relates with this kind of intent class, right? So here then, here's an example of, for example, a pattern. So we created this patterns like with the help of the data from our Red Cross colleagues, thanks to Patrick. We had received this data where we observed their searches, how they were manually data mining for the kinds of information that they needed. So using those, these patterns were acquired. And yeah, it's a feature which gives a binary feature, 0 or 1 value. Second, we abstracted the data. So again, following the thought of abstraction, that there can be importance of certain cues in the messages. So in our prior studies, information sharing, we had observed that if there is an information-rich content being shared, in that case, there could be numerics, there could be interactions, and there could be links. which would be helping or this kind of conversations for cooperation. Therefore, we want to leverage those as a features. Third,
Hemant?
Yes.
Can you provide some insight or some intuition as to why you chose a rule-based classifier here as opposed to other types of classifiers?
So, Shani, the goal is that we will infuse this also in the feature space because when we are defining rules for a document, and if a document is following that rule, we are actually associating a priori some sort of association with a class, that this particular message has some sort of association with the intent of seeking, or similarly for offering. So that was the reason why we wanted to introduce these patterns, which were rule antecedents in the feature space. Now, combining that with the bottom-up, what we are doing is we're creating this feature space rich so that we can efficiently learn. That was the motivation here.
Now, the reason I'm asking is that at least for a number of problems, rule-based classifiers generally are weaker from a performance standpoint in terms of accuracy when compared to, say, kernel methods or SVM-based approaches and things like that. So I'm missing in your thesis as well, that was going to be one of the comments I had, was why you chose this rule-based. I mean, You gave an answer right now, but you can make those kind of associations at some level in some kernel space as well. I mean, why is rule space important here?
Good point, Shrini. So if we look at the problem at a higher level that we are approaching, so these are associated with the kinds of organizational tasks. And so there is a knowledge which is available for us to leverage. And that knowledge that can be employed by these rules, which we did not have a luxury if we would have been approaching other problems, for example. That's one. And other is that actually, as you mentioned, that the accuracy has been weaker in like other senses. The challenge here is that intent is expressed by multiple items. If we think of a sequence, message is a sequence, multiple items in that message sequence would be relating with intent. That's why, Shani, in that what we want to do is by employing these kinds of rules, we want to help the finding of the statistical relationship between predictors and classes efficiently.
Perhaps we'll come back to it later.
Yeah, let me ask you one more question. So were these rules defined based on any psycholinguistic patterns and hence rule was chosen?
Yeah. So these rules that we had, so this was another study that we did, right, where we observed in the previous case, the rules were coming from the psycholinguistic classes, like we saw Levin's verb, and then. In this particular study, we observed directly coming from the domain guidance. We will see when we are generalizing these two together in our next step to this, we will see that we combine these different kinds of knowledge. And we also employ data mining to find these kinds of knowledgeful patterns a priori before we give for the classification. Okay, so here in the slide, we are discussing the kinds of top-down rules that we discussed, like from the declarative knowledge, and the bottom-up coming from just from the message, the engrams from the text. And then the sparsity issue, so that was for the ambiguity, but for the sparsity issue. We address this at the algorithmic choice level that we use feature selection, we use ensemble learning, and we use the classifier chain. Now, we did this to address the imbalance that we had, and prior literature has shown that ensemble-based approaches have done better for the imbalanced classes. So banking on that knowledge, we created a knowledge-driven feature space, and then we use that feature space in a classifier chain where for each intent at a time, we solve the problem. So first, for the seeking intent, for example, we observed seeking, not seeking, and then we use the probability of not seeking also in the second classifier. So that's why we are chaining here by first model to the second model. And in doing so, then we, in the experiments, we focused on seeking versus not seeking, offering versus not offering, two kinds of classifiers, likewise a baseline. And we used the data sets here, so 4,000 donation classified tweets in a data set of Hurricane Sandy, where donation classifier we had created, again, using the similar kind of features. We can discuss about it afterwards if you're interested. That was important to set up a goal. Or for the organizational task, for example, relief coordination. So the relief donation coordination is an important task for organizations. So we label with three judges annotations for seeking, offering, and none. And then we employed the classification algorithm on that feature space. And for the two kinds of models, first for seeking versus not seeking. So not seeking was also including neither of seeking, offering, as well as the offering. Based instances, while in the second case, there was just offering versus none instances. And we observed here, by doing the cost-sensitive learning, certain precision and the F major value. Now here, I want to emphasize that you can see the one in the brackets in the under the precision and F1 score column, that under the baselines are under the brackets. Actually, F1 score is low. If you observed for the second column. This was specifically by design. We wanted to ask this question that yes, we know that if you reduce the recall, precision can go high. We know that precision recall relationship. We wanted to see here, can we identify high precision messages or not? For example, when you take a high consequence situations like disasters and you have to decision making in that environment, you want to get a more precise answers, then actually giving me more data, but less precise. So this was also anecdotal when we were helping in the case of Oklahoma tornado, when we shared the data of just 150 offers and nearly 500 unique request-related messages with responding organizations, including Red Cross. When I, during 2013, Patrick, I worked with Patrick to figure that issue, that could we mine this data out of this 1.8 million messages within 2 days. So that was important anecdote to also say that this design issue. But however, let's say, let's talk in general, that can we now generalize this? Can we generalize the intent classification? And so that's why we want to approach the problem at the multi-class classification level, that whatever lessons we learn, the binary classification, that fusing top-down and bottom-up approach could improve the performance. We address this issue of sparsity and ambiguity by employing this fusion approach. We want to hypothesize here that can the knowledge-guided approach can also improve the multi-class classification accuracy or not for the intent. When we know that already that this problem of intent mining is challenging, so let's see whether it works or not. So we here, in this case, in the bottom-up approach, we consider that as the baseline, and then we use the top-down approach where we use this different kinds of knowledge. One was the declarative knowledge, one or another was the social knowledge that we observed in the previous problem, problem one of conversation classification, that offline theories were informing about certain cues. And the third, we want to leverage here our contrast patterns, and we will see why we do that. And using these two kinds of combinations, we create a hybrid approach. So here, the first thing was the bag of words, the bottom-up approach. So we use the bag of tokens. The second was the declarative knowledge patterns. So declarative knowledge patterns, so domain experts have some guidance. Our psycholinguistics had guidance as we observed in the binary classification, combining them two, and then expanding with the WordNet and Levin's work. So altogether, we created this rules, and this rules are binary features. Third was the social knowledge indicators that we observed in the case of conversation classification, because we observed there that the cues of conversation can be helpful in the online context analysis, social data analysis. So we want to leverage here, for example, dialogue management indicators, like thanks anyway, because often, as we saw, these are thrown away in the text. Analysis. The fourth thing that we did was about leveraging the power of data mining. So the goal of data mining is to also discover the knowledge from the data right? So from the corpus, can I discover the knowledge and then use that in the classification? So we wanted to use that as a pre-step. So the input corpus to it was a clean, like an abstracted text messages that was given to it. And each message was a sequence of these different tokens. And we gave a minimum support. Minimum support means how many times a particular pattern is occurring in the corpus. And then we use the X as a percentage, that how many top X percent we patterns that we should utilize. So for each class J, instead of doing the frequent this pattern mining on the entire corpus, we did it class-wise. Our goal here was to identify unique patterns with respect to classes. So finding the contrasting patterns, so we use the sequential pattern mining for each of the data of each of these classes. And then we identified this unique sequential patterns with respect to those classes, and we computed the contrast strength of these patterns, and we ranked those. So we picked like top 100% feature, which are just related with seeking, top 100% features, which are, let's say, just related with offering. So now, why that was important? So by finding these rules, the examples that I'm showing you here, like help victim URL. Now, these are not the kinds of association that were occurring right in the messages. If we try to look at all the data, and if we try to look at these bigrams only, or trigrams only, finding this distant, very distant tokens was challenging. So having this kind of knowledge as also patterns would be helpful for us. That was our hypothesis. And then the fifth kind of feature was the contrast patterns on the pose tags. So one of the study, especially even in the Holrit et al. And in the Verga et al., they had used this part of speech tags. So we wanted to employ on the part of speech tags also. So here, we used for multi-class classification two kinds of binarization frameworks. So multi-class classification problem is a challenging problem than the binary classification problem, because you have more classes to discriminate, and therefore there has been work in machine learning in discriminating these multiple classes. And while doing so, there is no one winner which has been observed. Like you can give to the learning space all the kinds of classes at one point of time. Another approach is you divide the problem into binary classifiers. The advantage of the binarization approach is that you can parallelly create those models. And you can therefore gain in the time that you create in learning. So we used, therefore wanted to observe that in the both kinds of binarization framework, can this fusion approach help or can it or can't it? So we used, so this is an example of one versus all, that you create for each class K, among our K classes, a classifier model. So from M1 to MK. And there is another one, so in this you are providing the data set for each class as a positive label, all the other classes as a negative label. There is another approach called one versus one, in which we have pairwise classes for discrimination. So we will be creating K into K minus 1/2 classifiers there. So having those binarization frameworks for multi-class classification with us, then we look at the experiments, and we looked at two kinds of data sets here. One was from the Hurricane Sandy, another was on the Philippines typhoon, and that the two very different kinds of characteristics, even real-world events. One was at the really global level, that it took a lot of global attention, the Philippine typhoon versus the Hurricane Sandy, which was more centered in the US. So the demographic, so there is the importance of it that we will see here. We use the parameters that for base learners, for those each of MJ is random forest, the ensemble based learning. And we time trees 100 features, and based on the best practices for the those classifiers that we observed in the literature, and then the bigram trigrams for the baselines, and the top we took all 100% of the features which were there as a contrasting patterns for each of the classes, with the minimum support 10% and 50% for the pose case versus just the textual sequences case. And here we observe the performances. So if we would have just used the baseline of bottom-up approach, we were here. But while we were going from adding and observing performance of each of these different kinds of knowledge sources, like declarative, social, and the contrast patterns, we observed interesting performance gain. And altogether, we observed the best performance, where the gain was statistically significant with 7% and the p-value less than 0.05 for the null hypothesis. So We observed the similar case for the Philippines typhoon that we were observing the gain by the fusion approach as compared to if we would have just taken the bottom-up approach for processing this. And we observed here again the performance gain, which was up to 6% and with a p-value.
Can you explain this?
So,
the declarative Social contrast and the relative performance. I guess the gray part is the
important. In very important question, Dr. Sheth. So that's why I was saying here that why those characteristic of the two event matters. So if you look at this Philippines typhoon case, you see the social performance here similar to declarator, yeah, and contrast performing well here. But when we go here, we see the social performing very well actually in this case as compared to the other case that for one of the cases, like one versus one. So in this case, especially for one versus. What we saw is also the kinds of event these are. This is a more English native speaking countries event, while here in this case, it was a global event. And that also informs about the language usage, which I suspect as one of the important point that there is a role of cultural sensitivity also in terms of what kind of psycholinguistics we are applying. So that was also one of the lessons that we had learned. So one of the lessons is, yes, that using the hybrid approach, we do better in learning the intent classes. And we observed that in the top 1% discriminative features, there were 50% knowledge-guided features. The second thing was this offline theoretic social conversation features, like this dialogue management indicator, often removed for the text processing. They have value here that they do play an important role. But also, yes, Shini.
I have a quick question here.
Yes, Shini.
You know that when you're looking at these kind of crisis events,
right,
that things are rapidly changing.
True.
Okay? As far as I understand it, the experiment you conducted here is assuming some kind of a static distribution. You're not really taking into account the fact that things are changing. And in fact, Val and I discussed this. We had a discussion about this, and we have a hypothesis. We don't know if it's true or not, but mm-hmm. something. There is going to be an alteration in the type of content a user uses on Twitter versus some sort of normative behavior when the particular user is involved or in sort of the crisis situation themselves. And it's not clear they're going to follow this kind of psycholinguistic behavior for crisis problems. Now again,
yes,
you use three from the crisis domain and three from somewhere else, but I just want...
Very good point, Shini. Very good point. In fact, I would agree with you. What is we are going to see, observing here is that in some part of the data, we will see this. Not in all part, as you mentioned. And there is actually interesting work from Dietrich, 2003, which talks about the stressful situations that people don't follow rules. There is an interesting study in psychology for that. So you are absolutely right on this point. What I'm trying to say here is that in some part of the data, these may play a role. And actually, when we are analyzing the data, actually employing these kinds of knowledge also helps, because this knowledge is useful on that part, that portion of the data.
So,
but see, the challenge, Hemant, is recognizing which part it's useful for, right? I mean,
yes.
I didn't see an example of that
mm-hmm.
in your methodology.
Mm-hmm.
Or is that something you have?
So, okay. So, to understand the question again, so. In which portion of the data we observed that there was a better performance for the social conversations-based cues as compared to the other? Yeah?
Shini?
Yeah, and the fact that this can change over time.
Right.
So,
Shini, I have not addressed the change over time issue at this point that I acknowledge. with the change in the content, because here we were doing offline learning where we were using all the data together.
Okay.
So, yeah.
That's fine. Yeah.
I have a related question.
Yes.
Have you tested data on one crisis, classifier learned from one crisis on another crisis?
No data.
So I guess that will make it useful. This is only, I guess this now is only understanding the crisis.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that will be helping to predict.
And then
use it. Here you see you need to have the crisis happening for a while to build the classifier, then classify for the same crisis.
Right.
But
so, very good, Dr. Dong. Very good point. I also want to add here another point that in the, if you look at the intent mining literature and the natural language understanding literature, there is a role of intent in a specific context also. So people use a lot of these cues from the context when they're describing their intent. So that's also another thing that I have noticed as an important factor. But I would like to experiment that as the next step. Yes,
ma'am. For CHB, didn't we run the models from one crisis
to
on the other?
Right. We did that in the case of conversation analysis.
Yes,
we did that for conversation and analysis, classification analysis to observe for the only offline theoretic features we had seen, that whether offline theoretic features are good in analyzing online social data of different kind. We had done there. But for the this purpose, we did not, for the intent purpose. Yes, Prabhu.
My question regarding the changing of content is, would that really impact your intent classification? So, because I understand content change, right? But you're specifically looking at classifying intent.
Right.
So, probably, you know, things might change from food to clothes, right?
Right.
But if you're classifying that kind of content, doesn't the pattern remain the same?
Overall,
the content would change because people, the locations change during disasters, or the kind of entities being spoken about would change.
Sure.
But when you're classifying just intents, wouldn't that remain more or less static, but change in the necessities?
Good question, Pern. So here, what you're really talking about that is, and the way I have looked at it, and I would like to address this also in future, is actually the problem of having the intent with the kind of topic. And does it change over time? Because topics are going to change over time in terms of the kinds of needs there are. And therefore, the intent for them is going to change or not. So that is something I have, yes, I'm basically investigating in the form of multi-label a learning problem, where I want to see if the kind of intent there is, if I have a asking intent, does it change with the kind of like topic of food versus the shelter? Yeah. So it's a yeah point. So it might not, but it's a good investigation question. So here, now, we want to look at now that using the prior knowledge and using features of user content network, can we efficiently model engagement? And in this, our objective is that if we relate back to our cooperative system design, we want to understand the prioritization that whom should be engaged. And so here, what question we are asking is that given engagement is a degree of involvement in discussions, and we look at the social network of the citizens and their community, and we'll observe that these all users are not same. These all users are different. They have a varying degree of engagement. So in this situation, how do I prioritize whom to engage? How do I find those reliable groups to engage with? And so we want to observe these reliable groups to engage for action by means of the groups which are staying focused, the groups which are collectively diverging. For example, if people were talking about issues with the flight delays or issues with this shelter, they talk about those subtopics under those over time. And so we want to ask this question here in the form of that why then the groups evolve over time? Can we better model this evolution of groups over time? And so here, first thing is we need to define what kind of groups. So we depended on interaction network. We observed that this static network of who is following whom and these kind of links between users, given these are emerging events, they were sparse. And so we had used on these interaction networks because interaction networks also relates with the conversations. The second thing was this defining this divergence of these groups that when they're collectively shifting their voices, in that we use the content-based measure as compared to the structure-based measures, because content-based measure can actually inform us about why groups are diverging. And the third thing was the predicting the change in this divergence between the time slices. So I'm not going into details on this particular problem given the time limit. So I would like to rather follow the lessons that we had here. That first lesson was that content-based divergence can help us explain why the groups evolve over time. And so actually we can get the access to the prioritized set of groups. For example, when we looked at the content of this less divergent group versus the more divergent group. And what we observed that less divergent groups, they write more focused content. They were staying focused, and there was an example that we observed in Hurricane Sandy data sets as well, that in Hurricane Sandy case, there was one group which was focused on starting to the end on flight delays, just about flights, information about flights. First delays, then complete halt, then resuming completely. So these kinds of focus groups can be important to engage, and so content-based measure help us achieve that. Second, that in emerging events such as disaster, we observed that there was correlation with the social identity features. So we want to observe, so we had modeled the features using the social identity cohesion theories and social sciences. So social identity is like in a group, people are sharing their identities. For example, all are technocrats, or all are from one region, or all are from talking about higher degree of the different kinds of topics. So, and in this kind of situations, they're carrying out certain identities, and how those identities affect. That was our goal there. And after doing this kind of analysis, we also created certain applications from this kind of research. First was when a disaster event is occurring, there are responding organizations who are monitoring the situation, and there are citizens who are generating a lot of information. In that, these messages of this kind, like seeking intent and offering intent, they are also occurring. And so identifying those intent would be valuable for the organization's task of understanding the resource availability and the needs. So we created intent classifier as a service, and it was actually integrated by Ushahidi as well. Ushahidi is a crisis net project which provides all different kinds of crisis data in real time. So they use this service as to provide this kind of information that messages about related to asking needs or offering different kind of resources. The second application is building this tool for user engagement, that how respond organization can engage with the citizen sensor. So we created this tool to mine the networks of people who are important and giving the list of those such people. For example, on the left-hand side, you see the different important users, for example, humanitarian background or journalism background users. And this was also winner on the IT Using Innovator Challenge on disaster management. So ultimately, what we try to address, a piece of the puzzle of this entire big complex corporate system design, that for awareness, we address a piece of it as one question using engagement modeling, that whom to prioritize to engage, and in the articulation using intent mining, the kinds of information that is going to assist the organization's specific task. And in doing so, just like every other research, this research has limitations too. For example, we have not addressed all kinds of questions which relate with the awareness, like where are things being needed or what is being needed. So location-based analysis, time-based analysis. So we haven't done that. We are approaching that with the domain model, like the extending the domain ontology for intent, the ontology humanitarian exchange language in the space of crisis computing. And for intent mining, how to mine the actor-specific intent. Like you observed that we were looking at the document's intent. Not within the document, whose intents are. For example, Red Cross has an intent, or some particular organization has an intent. Like So in that situation, how do you mine the actor space we can learn? For group engagement, how to incorporate the intent in the group divergence, and that would actually essentially also go along the question that Srini was asking about the change in the dynamics. So I would like to investigate the question that Srini was asking in this direction as well by fusing the intent in the divergence as well. And the last thing is the also bipartite intent matching. Once we now know the corpuses of different kinds of intent, complementary intent of seeking and offering, can we do the bipartite matching on it, and can we do it efficiently? So we are investigating that as well as to address not just assistant of the coordination, but actually doing the coordination modeling using the matching. And also the limitations have been, among others, has been the platforms. So we have looked at Twitter, but yes, obviously other platforms are there. So that is like my immediate future investigation. In conclusion, I want to again reemphasize the statement of using the prior knowledge with the interplay of user content network features efficiently model the intent and engagement problem for cooperation of citizen sensor communities. I want to thank Professor Sheth, my advisor, who has been great, really in keeping me on track and understanding the problem at a high level in terms of use of the analysis and not just analysis. Doug Dong, who helped me understand the contrast patterns knowledge. Srini, who always pushed me for, can we do better? I'll always remember his push of, can we do better? And Dr. Prasad, who always helped me being problem-centric. Patrick, who has been great in making sure in terms of the simplicity of what we build, does it have a use in a simple form for the organizational tasks as well? And Val, who has been not just my advisor and in the advising role of just the person from social sciences, but has helped me a lot in terms of communication and being a better person. So thanks to Val as well. And I want to thank my interdisciplinary mentors from Wright State, as well as from QCRI, from Fernando at MSR, and Mina, who's my initial mentor here as well, IBM. Noise's esteemed colleagues, all the great friends who have been here. Without you guys, this journey wasn't possible. And also my colleagues in the volunteer communities, from crisis mappers, from standby task force, from Ushahidi, from Humanity Roads, and so on, as well as the domain experts in the organizations. So I want to thank all these organizations as well, and I would be now open to questions. I have also worked on other problems in my course of PhD, but we can discuss if you are interested. We have addressed these various challenges for those in respect to problems of ambiguity, sparsity, diversity, and scalability. But we can come to that if you are interested. Thank you very much, and I'm open to questions now.
One minor question.
Yeah.
How did you measure information density in conversation?
Good question, Dr. Dong. So we looked at the specific psycholinguistic categories of specific words, like social sense or communication. That has been studied in psychology literature to express a form of coordination or cooperation. And so based on those measures, we were saying that the things which were classified with the help of offline theoretic cues, they had a higher information density. So we have to put it in the context that information for cooperation purpose. Any other questions?
Go ahead, another one.
Yes.
I want to see it.
So, Amit, is there a certain procedure here for questions? Is this part of the, perhaps you can tell us a little bit about the format here. Is there going to be a private session? Or
yeah,
is it everything public?
Yeah, there will be private session things. So right now it's open for anybody, and
I will just hold my questions for the private session.
Yeah, the committee can hold on us now, but I think there is a wider audience that can ask the questions now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you separated the declarative knowledge and the behavioral knowledge.
Right.
So is there a reason for why you
separated? Hemant, please repeat the question because I can't hear.
Yes, Shani. I will.
So in the prior knowledge, so there are various categories. So where there is declarative knowledge and there is behavioral knowledge. So I was wondering, why can't everything be declarative knowledge? If you already know something about the domain, isn't it already declarative?
So that's a very good question in terms of why we separate the declarative versus social. So to go fine-grained in describing that what kind of different knowledge sources are there, because we saw the effect, right? For on one data set, these social cues, they were effective, but not in the other case, right? So that, and similarly for the declarative, it can be there. So we want to separate the declarative knowledge of coming from the domain experts who are guiding that what is important for them and how they express, right? But does not mean that they are aware of all kinds of things in the behavioral understanding and psychology about how we converse and all. That is why, Pramod, we want to distinguish and see the effects that if someone is providing the declarative knowledge versus if we can come up with the sources coming from the social cues.
So in your context, declarative knowledge was those patterns given by crisis workers.
Yeah.
Okay.
No questions, guys? No? For all right, so we'll excuse the audience then.